Let us praise Jesus, the washer of feet. Jesus, the lordly, who gave up his seat. Jesus, the maker of all that there is. Jesus, the servant to all who are his. We praise Jesus.
We praise Jesus.
We praise Jesus.
Good evening, and welcome to our act of worship for Maundy Thursday, where we remember Jesus sharing his Last Supper with his disciples. You may want to take a moment now just to gather perhaps a piece of bread and some wine or some juice so that they will be there as symbols of remembrance through this service. On the table in the midst of this community with whom Christ is present, we set symbols to remind us of his promises to us.
A candle to remind us of the way. I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life.
Water, to remind us of Jesus' promise of life. Those who drink the water I will give will never be thirsty again. It becomes a fresh, bubbling spring within them, giving them eternal life.
Bread, to remind us of God's love. I am the bread of life that came down from heaven. Whoever eats this bread will live forever. This bread is my flesh, which I give for the life of the world.
God, we welcome your presence with us. May the companionship we share nourish our hearts and minds. May our spirits be refreshed as we live in the light of your presence with us now and at all times and places. Amen. Together we join in a journey of remembrance of 3 days that changed the world and changed our lives. Followers of Jesus have been taking this journey since his first followers took it long ago. This is the night of love. This is the night of love. On this night, followers of Jesus have welcomed those who have returned to the way of Jesus after a time of wandering and a journey of returning. This is the night of love. This is the night of love. This is the night of love. And so on this night, we welcome the penitent, the broken. We welcome the doubters. All here have wandered. All here are learning. Let us all here join in hearing and obeying the commandment of our Master, that we love one another as he has loved us. This is the night of love. This is the night of love. Come all who are sinners. Come all who are thirsty. Come all who are weary. Come to the night of love. And so we make our confession. Merciful God, we confess that so often our discipleship has been weak when we have failed to serve as Jesus served. Forgive us. When we have failed to love one another as Jesus loves us, forgive us. When we have been happy to proclaim our devotion to Jesus with our lips and then denied him with our actions, forgive us. We say together, merciful God, empower us by your Spirit to be steady and true to you in every time of trial, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And God assures us of his forgiveness. Jesus said, I come not to judge the world, but to save the world. And having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The good news, therefore, is this. In Jesus Christ, we are loved and we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen. This is the night of love. Jesus took a towel and a basin and washed his disciples' feet, reversing roles of master and student, servant and host, and told them to do the same, to show the world God's love and theirs.
Please, can I have some water? Thank you. Here, let me take this. Andrew, come here. Here, let me take this. Thank you.
That's our job.
It's all right. Andrew?
Master, you mustn't.
Please. Now, all of you.
This is work.
Yeah. It's all right, come on.
This is servant's work.
James?
Lord, you're going to wash my feet?
You don't know what I'm doing, but later you'll understand.
No, you will never wash my feet.
If I do not wash you, you have no part with me.
Well, if that be so, Lord, then not just my feet, but my head and my hands as well.
He was bathed and he'd only wash his feet. His whole body is clean. And you, Peter, you're clean. But not every one of you. Now, do you understand what I'm doing for you?
No, Master.
I can't really.
No.
I don't understand.
Do you?
No, Master.
See, I'm giving you an example that you should do as I've done for you. You call me teacher, yes? You call me Lord. Rightly so. That is who I am. Know then that your Lord, your teacher, has washed your feet. So you must wash one another's feet. I've given you an example that you should do as I've done for you. Now the servant is not greater than his master, is he? Nor a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you'll be blessed if you do them.
But Lord, why are you leaving us?
I go so that all mankind be saved. Generations still unborn, they'll live in fellowship and harmony.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Now before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The devil had already put it into the heart of Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray him. And during the supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe and tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet and to wipe them with a towel that was tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered, "You do not know now what I am doing, but later you will understand." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no share with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head." Jesus said to him, "One who has bathed does not need to wash, except for the feet, but is entirely clean. And you are clean, though not all of you." For he knew who was to betray him. For this reason, he said, "Not all of you are clean." After he had washed their feet, had put on his robe, and had returned to the table, he said to them, "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example, that you shall also do as I have done to you. Very truly I tell you, servants are not greater than their master, nor are messengers greater than the one who sent them. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them. Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself, and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and as I said to the Jews, so I now say to you. Where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I loved you, you also should love one another. By this everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another." This is the Gospel of the Lord.
I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. By this everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love one for another. I suppose these days that Maundy Thursday comes and goes with hardly any thought or recognition at all. Maybe a brief clip on the TV of the Queen distributing what is called the Royal Maundy, but then that's about all, and of course this year not at all, due to the pandemic. So what then can we say about Maundy Thursday? Well, actually quite a lot. In the first place, it takes its name, Maundy, from the Latin word mandatum, meaning commandment, a reminder of Jesus' command to his disciples at the Last Supper and following the washing of their feet, that they should love one another. The fact that the Queen still distributes the royal maundy takes us back to a long-standing tradition from the 13th century in England, when King John in the year 1210 distributed forks and food and clothing to the poor of the area, an event which first took place actually quite near here at Knaresborough. 2 years later in Rochester saw the monarch distributing the coins which have come to be associated with this occasion and which still continue today. From time to time, the service of the royal maundy also involved the monarch washing the feet of 12 poor people, again following the example of Jesus at the Last Supper. The context for all of this, as our gospel reading makes clear, is the festival of Passover, the major festival for Jewish people then as now. The Passover meal was a recalling, a symbolic reenactment, as it were, of that great salvation event never to be forgotten, when the people of Israel, fleeing from their Egyptian pursuers, miraculously escaped through the Red Sea to their freedom eventually in the Promised Land. After all, they were being pursued by the massive horde of Pharaoh's army, huge numbers of horses and chariots. They didn't stand a chance, or so they thought, as they found themselves, almost literally, between the devil and the deep blue sea. And what was the advice they were given? Moses says to them, "Do not be afraid. Stand firm, and you will see the deliverance that the Lord will accomplish for you today. The Lord will fight for you. You have only to keep still." And with that, their way through the Red Sea opened up. They passed through on dry land, only for the waters to close in over their pursuers. A quite unique and never to be forgotten event in the memory of Israel to this very day. It was a Passover from certain death to life. Now, whether the supper that Jesus was taking with his disciples was the actual Passover meal or not, it was certainly taken in the context of this great celebration, a prefiguring, of course, of the Passover from death to life, which Jesus himself would accomplish in his forthcoming death and resurrection. A prefiguring of that Passover from death to life for each and every one of us who have been baptized into the death and resurrection of Jesus, as St. Paul puts it. And of course, it's the Passover which is the context for the Christian Passover meal, so to speak, which we observe every time we celebrate the Lord's Supper, Holy Communion, the Eucharist, the Mass, call it what you will. We similarly do this in remembrance, as Paul reminds his Corinthian hearers. As often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Once again, this never-to-be-forgotten event of the Lord's death and resurrection has become, for Christian people the world over and from the very beginning, what our prayer books call the principal Sunday service, as so it remains Sunday by Sunday. Often we use the acclamation, "Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again." One distinguished theologian writes that at the celebration of Holy Communion, the Lord's Supper, time is transcended altogether. The worshipper is present at the Last Supper, in the upper room, on Golgotha, in the Garden of the Resurrection, at the golden altar before the heavenly throne. The celebration of Holy Communion shows forth the Lord's death, but also anticipates his future coming. Celebrated in the here and now, pointing backwards to the one and forwards to the other, truly a mystery of our faith. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. At the end of every service of Holy Communion, we are charged, go in peace to love and serve the Lord. And it's this love and service which is at the heart of our observance of Maundy Thursday, a reminder and a challenge to what is at the heart of the gospel, the good news which Jesus brings and himself lives out as he gives of himself his very life in the service of others. The action of King John and his successors to the present day was meant to be a symbol of the service, the love and the care the leader has for those over whom he or she is set. As Christ humbled himself to wash the feet of the disciples, so the first in the land is called to be not to be served, but to serve, and to give themselves to a life of service. But then whoever we are, whatever our station, our position in life, we are all equal in the eyes of God, no one better or worse, no one higher or lower. All of us are called to a life of service and care and love. For as St. John puts it in his first letter, how can we love God whom we have not seen if we do not love a sister or brother whom we have seen? And yes, love is costly. It's not that sentimental mush, nor is it all about sex. It's about our readiness to go the extra mile, to put ourselves out, to spend ourselves and be spent in the flourishing not just of ourselves, but of each other, of our whole community, that life in all its fullness, which Jesus wills for the people of the whole world. And so I conclude with the words of a well-known hymn, which in fact says it all rather better, I think, than I. Brother, sister, let me serve you. Let me be as Christ to you. Pray that I may have the grace to let you be my servant too. We are pilgrims on a journey and companions on the road. We are here to help each other walk the mile and bear the load. When we sing to God in heaven, we shall find such harmony, born of all that we've known together, of Christ's love and agony.
Our second hymn is "A New Commandment I Give Unto You, That You Love One Another As I Have Loved You." On this night, Jesus broke bread and shared wine with his followers for the last time and invited them to remember him, to encounter him anew whenever they did the same. This is the night of love. This is the night of love.
Now, it told us in the last story, the one about the donkey, that Jesus and his friends were going to Jerusalem to celebrate the Passover, which was a Jewish religious festival. Jesus and his friends, of course, were Jewish. Now, part of the Passover involved having a special meal together. Lots of religious festivals involve that, don't they? We might have Christmas dinner at Christmas, Easter eggs at Easter, breaking the fast in Ramadan. It's a common thing. Because they didn't live in Jerusalem, Jesus and his friends had to find somewhere where they could eat their meal. So he did the weird instructions thing again. He called two of his friends to him. We know it was Peter and John. And he said, "You two, go into the city. You'll find a man carrying a water jar. Follow him home into his house. And when he asks what you want, say you've come to see the room for the teacher to have his meal." Those are strange instructions, aren't they? I was thinking, how would they know they'd got the right person? Then I found this out. You see, carrying the water jar was women's work. Normally women did it. If you saw a man with a jar, that was really unusual. So when Peter and John went into the city and they saw a man carrying a jar, they knew he was the right one to follow. They went to his house, through the door, and he turned round and saw them and said, "What do you want?" And they said, "We've come to see the room where the teacher can have his meal." And he said, "You can use my room upstairs." We don't know why he let them use it. Maybe Jesus had prearranged it. Maybe he's Jesus's friend. Maybe he's just got a spare room that he rents out during times like the Passover to make a bit of extra money. Who knows? But he lets them use it. So Peter and John set up for the Passover meal. They get all the special foods together and they lay the table. And later that night, Jesus and his friends gather in the upper room of the man's house. They would have gathered round a table. This is my dining room table where I'm sat now. Their table would have been quite a lot lower than mine, and they wouldn't have sat on chairs, they would have reclined on cushions around the table. You know what it's like when you get your friends and family together for a celebration meal, for Christmas or a birthday. It's not quiet, is it? It's not calm. Everybody's talking, everybody's laughing, telling stories and jokes. Maybe a couple of people are fighting at one end of the table, someone else is sulking because they've got to sit next to somebody they don't really like. It's definitely not quiet. And I think that's probably what it's like for Jesus and his friends at the start of this meal. They've had the entry into Jerusalem on the back of the horse. Everyone was cheering for them. Jesus has been going around. Crowds are gathering to hear him. Things are good. And so, in the middle of the meal, when Jesus starts to say quite strange things, it becomes pretty unsettling because they thought everything was going so well. You see, Jesus, he turns to them and he says, "Friends, I'm really glad that I got to eat this meal with you again. This is the last time I will share the Passover meal until it reaches its full meaning in the kingdom of God." They must be thinking, what does he mean by that? He's always saying strange things. Then he says something even stranger because he picks up the bread, just bread. He holds it up. His bread would have been flat bread, not like this, more like a kind of wrap or something like that. But he picked up the bread, that most ordinary of things off the table, and he said, this bread is my body. Eat it and remember me. That is weird, isn't it? Imagine on Christmas Day, if your mum picked up a bit of turkey and she went, "This turkey is like my body. Eat it and remember me." And then she passed it round. You'd laugh at her, wouldn't you? Because it'd be weird. But that's what Jesus did. This bread is like my body. Eat it and remember me. And he broke it. And he passed it round. And they all ate some. "I've got some bread. You might want to eat some now. It's pretty good. Share it with the people that you're with." After they'd eaten the bread, Jesus picked up a cup. His cup would have had wine in it. Mine has juice. Hopefully yours does too. And he picked it up and he said, "This wine is like my blood. Drink it and remember me." And he passed it round and they all had a drink. You could do that now too. Now, Jesus' friends must have wondered what on earth he was going on about. They didn't know what was coming next, but he did. Lots of Christians believe slightly different things about what Jesus was doing when he shared the bread and wine. Churches across the world still do this now. They might call it Holy Communion or the Lord's Supper or Mass. But it is remembered in churches everywhere. Here is what I think Jesus was doing. Out of all the foods and drink on that table, all the special Passover foods that there were, he chose bread. Just ordinary bread. The kind of thing that they ate every single day. And he chose wine. Just wine. It's a special drink now, but in those days they used to drink it every day because the water wasn't always clean. Off that table, he chooses ordinary things, bread and wine, because he wants them to remember him. He knows what's going to happen next. He knows that he's going to die. He knows he's going to leave them. And I think it works, doesn't it, this using food and drink to remember people. I don't know about you, but every time I have a cup of tea, I think about my dad, because he taught me how to make tea. He drinks tea all the time. And every time I have a cup of tea, I think, oh, that my dad's having a cup of tea too. Or my Nana, who died when I was about 8, before we died, she used to make a Sunday dinner, and she used to put herbs in her gravy, and it used to have a really distinctive smell. And now, even now, all these years later, if I smell those herbs, straight away I think about my Nan and her Sunday dinners and her house and all the things we used to do together and the toys we used to play with and the games we used to play and reading together. And it all floods through my mind just from the smell of the herbs in the gravy. Food and drink, our senses, are powerful things. Jesus is choosing things that they will eat and hold and smell every day to say, don't forget me. Remember everything we've done together, everything you've seen, everything I've taught you. Remember me and carry on my work. Then, after they've eaten and drunk, he turns to them again and he says, one of you, my friends, is going to let me down. One of you will betray me. I am going to die, and one of you will hand me over to my enemies to be killed. They must be looking at each other thinking, who is it? Is it you? Is it you? Is it you? What if it's me? What if I do it and I don't even mean to? What does he mean? And suddenly, things are feeling pretty different, aren't they? We know the end of the story. We know what happened next, but they didn't. Here's what they do know. When Jesus says something, it happens. Jesus says, you'll find a donkey tied to a wall. Bring it here and I will ride on it. And it happens. Jesus says, you'll see a man carrying a water jar. Follow him and we'll have dinner at his house. And it happens. So when Jesus says, one of you is going to betray me and I will be killed, they know, don't they? It's going to happen. And suddenly this bit of the story feels quite different, doesn't it? At the end of the first bit, Palm Sunday, it was happy, it was excited, there was cheering, everyone was pleased to see Jesus. How quickly things have changed. Feels pretty different now. Frightening, nervous, worried. What does it mean? So remember bread and wine, remember Jesus, remember how it feels at this bit of the story.
Thank you.
And so we make our final responses. This is a night to remember. This is a time for reflection. This is a time of prayer, because he first loved us. This is a time to love others. This is a night of love. Amen. This is the night of love. Go forth in the strength of Christ, in the care of this community, and with the love and blessing of our triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.